I'm pretty jealous of you guys because it is a super challenging time to work in advertising. And I mean, we have all these conversations, not so much about the do-good stuff, but we have a lot of conversations around artificial intelligence, robotics, Facebook, social media, and all that stuff. But also think, although it's challenging, it's also super exciting because when I started in advertising, I was 21 when I started, we had like billboards, we had radio, that was about it. And you're probably going to be the first generation that has the reach and the ability with one idea to change the world. And I think that is fucking fascinating and a big responsibility on you guys. So I also do have one beef, because I've been in this do-good space for quite some time. The book is pretty old now, 2012 or something. So I've kind of been observing this space for quite some time. And most of the stuff I see in award shows and around the world, most of it's gimmicks, and it's done to enter into awards. So there's not a lot of impact behind it. Because most of the time, you probably forget to ask yourselves, what are the difference we're doing? How many lives have we saved? How many carbon emissions? What are the liters of waters we have saved? So what I want you to do is really to risk stuff and do stuff and dare to change stuff. So I'm going to teach you one word today. So you're probably all, I'm from Denmark, I can't hide that. You know, the curly hair, tall, blue eyes, okay? I'm from Denmark. So I don't know how many of you know the Danish word hygge. Anybody? Hygge? You haven't heard hygge? Some of you, okay, good. So some of you have heard the word hygge. Good, so I'm going to teach you another Danish word that's equally important. And I want you to say it, okay? So it's called nosser. So try and say it. There's a few Danes here, so they're laughing already, so I'm giving it away already. But anyways, to try and say nosser, easy word, right? So it means bald. And I think that is really what is needed, or the female equivalent anyway, that is really what is needed today. Because the thing is, we are stuck with short-term thinking. Most of the stuff we do, and I know we've been through recession, so it's all been about sales results, about quarterly results, but even the way we do our work, it's all about campaigns and campaign cycles. And if you think about it, even how we work, it's almost like a thought-like machine. Client comes with brief, out comes creative output. That's not fucking brilliant if you want to deal with kind of long-term stuff. So somehow we've got to change this fucking whole system if we want to do advertising for good. Because I think the one thing, because we're not in the industry of selling shit, because people got more than enough shit already. What we're here to do is to build brands, and brands that last. And I think quite often we are undervalued as an industry. Because if we think about it, most of a company's value is tied into that little thing called a brand. I think that's super, super fascinating. But the one thing that's challenging today, and that's the thing I'm going to talk about today, so it's actually going to be a completely new topic. I'm writing a new book on it, so you're going to be the first guys who are going to hear about it. Anyways, it's not finished, still working on it. So the one thing that I think is super interesting is, yes, you can create amazing ideas, you can change the world with ideas, but we're not the only ones who are cool anymore, because today people are the creators of marketing, they are the creators of businesses, so they're challenging everything we do. So when you have one great idea, you're not just up against everybody in this room to stand out and create amazing stuff, you're up against millions and billions of people around the world. And right now, I don't see the exciting do-good stuff from the ad industry far between. The amazing stuff I see come from social entrepreneurs, environmental entrepreneurs. I have a big passion for Africa. Africa have a lot of great shit coming for it because they get it. So you're up against all of those people, and that's the challenge. So my mission, I don't know if there's any copywriters in the house. Any copywriters? Cool. I always love copywriters, maybe because I was a copywriter myself. So I started when I was 21, and both my parents are public school teachers. So there's one truth about public school teachers is for some reason they always hate advertising. So I kind of felt guilty probably through most of my career in advertising about doing what I was doing. And I really didn't feel very connected with selling shit at people. So this has been my mission of the last 8 years or so, really with a strong belief that we can turn brands around and get them to do more good. But also, I'm immensely disappointed, as I said, because most of the time this do-good stuff, I don't know if there's any surface, but it almost feels like it's pissing in a wetsuit. Feels warm and nice to begin with, but it quickly begins to stink. So We need to avoid the stuff we do that it stinks. So I'm going to talk about the kind of elephant in the room in this whole thing, the thing about selling stuff. So recently, I had a trip to Sao Tome and Principe. It's a small island off the coast of Guinea, and so off Nigeria, Gabon. And as I said, I'm a surfer. So I was looking for a surfboard so I could go and surf those beautiful waves. And so I'm driving around the coastline, and there's these guys out surfing. And I just kind of hit the brake, run down on the beach, and I'm like waving at them like a crazy guy. Kind of like, I want your surfboards. And the guy are kind of coming in, and these are the guys. And it wasn't surfboards. They were surfing these kind of wooden planks. And it kind of shows also a thing about creativity and getting the most out of nothing, really. But what I'm also sharing this is really that it's almost like we believe that things are going to make us happy. Advertising is almost like alcoholism. It makes us believe that that next thing is going to make us happy. So I think we almost forgot the one thing we learned when we were kids, which is the kind of essence of the Jungle Book. I don't know how many of you all know the Jungle Book, right? I'm just going to show a short video of the Jungle Book because I think it's brilliant and it can teach us so much in our industry.
Look for the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your strife. I mean the bare necessities or Mother Nature's recipes that bring the bare necessities of life. Wherever I wander, wherever I roam, I couldn't be found off my big home. The bees are buzzing.
I think you get it, right? The bare necessities. So the thing is just, if we want to solve any of this stuff, and the big thing we need to solve in the advertising industry is we got guys like these in China, and if all we can do is create aspirations for people to buy more stuff, we won't have enough stuff on this planet. And sometimes we can, of course, complain that we're stuck in a small East London apartment, and yes, we want more stuff. But I think what is really changing is when I was 14, my biggest wish was a boombox. Do you know what a boombox is? One of those with like CD player, 2 cassette tapes. That was my biggest wish when I turned 14. And I was nagging my parents like hell. Remember, they were school teachers. School teachers are a little bit slow to work with. But anyway, I got the boombox and I was super happy. My brother got a daughter, so that's my niece. She turned 14 this year. And she came to what I'll tell myself I am, her favorite uncle. And her wish for her, and she's like a tiny girl like this, tiny, tiny girl, curly hairs, beautiful girl, anyway. But her biggest wish was jumping out in a parachute from an airplane. And I was like, I'm not going to be the uncle who gave you that present for several reasons. But also does show the shift in mindset from stuff to experiences to self-realization. And we in the brand building business, so how can we make that pivot? So the best things in life aren't things. So let's start the conversation from there, okay? So how do we do this? How do we craft these brands for good? And how is that changing? Because most of the time when I see something coming out advertising about purpose, it's always Simon Sinek and Begin With Why. Always. That's always how advertising agencies craft purpose. That's a shame. And as I said, most of the stuff we do, it's always about the saying part. It's not about the doing part. And the saying part is only the little tip of the iceberg. Everything underneath, that's the interesting part. And when we say stuff, when we just try to look good, but we don't do good, that doesn't look good. It looks something like this. Doesn't look good. So what has changed, and I want to talk about how everybody wants to be famous, how we don't own the media space anymore. And I think one of the most exciting things that happened last year was, of course, the Me Too movement. Kind of shows the pivot that the biggest movement of last year, probably the most important thing last year, was not created by our industry, but by everybody. It doesn't even have an elected leader. It doesn't even have a manifest, the Me Too movement. So what do we do as advertising industry? Which I think is super disappointing. So we do stuff like this, because we want to play along, right? So McDonald's flipping its arches for Women's Day. I didn't even know that the M stood for man bond, male, whatever. And people, of course, get super upset. So why don't people trust us in industry when we do this stuff? Because we don't really have a history for doing it. I mean, look at advertising like this. Sorry. You mean a woman can open it? So people don't really trust us. So when I talk about in the beginning of the book of Gurgatize and said that 78%, according to Harvard's Meaningful Brands, believe that brands should be the ones that solve stuff. Is that truly so? Because the stories we're telling are unfortunately still this stuff. Stuff that goes back to the 60s, buy more stuff, you're gonna be happy. So who are gonna create the change that is needed? And I know that since you chose this session compared to another session, probably you guys have purpose in life and want to do something. So probably some of you will run around with a bag like this, a reusable shopping bag, because you want to say no to plastic bags, right? So don't panic, it's organic, you're feeling good about yourself. Truth told though, you have to use that bag 7,100 times before it's better than a plastic bag. So even when we want to do good, it's not easy. But the thing that excites me the most, and the thing that I look into the most at the moment, is how people are changing this narrative day by day. I don't trust statistics a lot, but I actually do trust what people are starting to share in social media. So people are sharing different ways of transportation, human part transportation. I'm from Copenhagen, so we got our fair shares of bikes. I'm one of the slow bike riders, and that's dangerous in Copenhagen, because I'm texting on my bike, and I'm drinking coffee and all that stuff, and then you have one of those fast-moving bikes. So it's a dangerous landscape in Copenhagen. But also, people starting to grow their own food. People starting to preserve natural resources. So people are suddenly starting to create change themselves, which I think is super fascinating. So I talked about how people today look to brands and expect them to play their fair share and to solve some of this stuff. I think this is where we traditionally start in advertising and say, let's try and shape brands, let's create brands that are a force for good. But I think the most exciting movement, and these are numbers that came out of the US last year from cahnge, where it says that actually 43% of people now believe that they are the agents of change. And I think that is interesting, that people are starting to give up on brands, because suddenly, probably we haven't given them what they wanted, probably we haven't taken that responsibility seriously as an industry and started solving stuff. So as I said, we are not in control anymore. This little guy's in control. This baby photos uploaded by massive amounts, so we don't even own the media space anymore. All the content out there is created by people, and it outcries what we're trying to do in the industry. Just one short example. So when Buzz Aldrin went to the moon, he took 5 photos. That was all he did, right? So any man or woman that goes to the bathroom these days will probably have taken 37 photos before you kind of got that Instagram, Snapchat ready look, right? So we are producing all this stuff. So how do we work in this world? And I think Andy Warhol was the guy who said, you know, in the future everybody will be world famous in 15 minutes. But how do we manage that as an advertising industry? How do we craft brands around that? And as I said, I don't think we're being valued enough as an industry. And we talk a lot about how the consultancies are eating fucking our lunch. It's not true, because we are holding the most valuable asset. It's the brand. And every time that brand is being challenged, and there's stories all the time in the news media, this was from a US, kind of like a right-wing woman who didn't get her right seat on a Delta flight. But what I thought was interesting about this whole thing was afterwards the Delta CEO felt unfairly treated by a woman on Twitter. So the CEO of a billion-dollar company feels unfairly treated by a woman on Twitter. But that kind of shows that something is changing. Or this one, probably some of you have seen this guy who got pulled out of United Airlines flight, $250 million off the value. Value that all of us should protect and create. Volkswagen is probably one of the most interesting examples these days. But what's also interesting about that was just a year after that whole Dieselgate thing happened, sales actually went back on track. Maybe it's because people don't give too much of a damn about the environment, or maybe it's because Volkswagen got a strong brand. Or this one, the Uber CEO, Travis, got actually sacked by one of his employees. So suddenly our people are taking over this marketplace. And they're not only taking over and being able to challenge brands, they're also starting to produce stuff. I'm sure some of you actually does have stuff up there on Etsy, People Part Marketplace. Or maybe somebody is going out there and changing the IKEA furnitures. I actually love this little site, full of IKEA hacks, stuff that we can do to change the stuff. So there's so much people part business out there, and it seems like there's no stopping in terms of what people can do. And this is probably a really good example of that. Cody Wilson, who set out to put out the kind of recipe for a gun, a 3D printed gun. So it was online for 72 hours before the FBI shut it down, 100,000 downloads of that little recipe. For those of you who heard my talk last year, I talked about Wheelies, the fastest growing coffee chain, started by a Swedish woman called Marie Delacroix, and she wanted to challenge the big brands. And I thought it was super fascinating, because when you normally start a coffee business like Starbucks, you've got to have $500,000 to be able to take part in that. For her, it's buying a coffee cart, it's like $5,000. So when we talk about purpose, where do people feel that burning passion to go out and do stuff? When you work in a Starbucks, or when you have your own little amazing coffee bar, where do you get the best service? Because by the end of the day, this is also about the quality and the price and the product and all that stuff. Where do people get the best service? And her mission is really about breaking down the hegemony of all these big brands. So people are giving a fuck finger to all the stuff that we built over the last couple of years. And you probably heard the statistic about the majority of people don't give a damn if half the brands are around tomorrow or not. But I think the most interesting thing when we build brands is that we still believe some of the lies that we're telling people. If you look at Ben & Jerry's, you know, they have a product started by Ben & Jerry. All of us always talk about Ben & Jerry's like a super purposeful company. And yes, it's purposeful. But if you look at it, why should we buy Ben & Jerry's? I mean, when I grew up, Ben & Jerry's was probably, together with Häagen-Dazs, some of the best ice cream you could get. It was fucking lovely, great tasting ice cream. But today, I mean, just in Copenhagen, I have a Italian guy who does amazing fucking gelato just around the corner. I got two guys who does ice cream out of a fresh cream that arrives every morning at the door. Where do I feel the passion? Where do I feel the purpose? So do we still believe in this stuff that we craft and we say Unilever's brands, the most purposeful brands? Do we still believe this shit? Because where do we have the purpose? And purpose comes with principles. Because so often people come to me and say, there was a time where having a principle would cost you something. Today it's almost like people come and say, you know, we want to have good advertising because principles sell more. That's not what I'm saying. Principles are still going to cost you something. I really like what Elon Musk was doing the other day on the backside of the whole kind of Facebook analytical scandal. Pulled the plug on his Facebook accounts on Tesla and SpaceX. Didn't pull it on Instagram though, so there's a thing there. So the shift we're seeing, which I think is super, super interesting, and we're in the midst of this, is kind of moving from the old school model that I grew up in, and we're probably somewhere here, it's like a tug of war somewhere, and we are approaching this kind of democratic, super exciting marketplace, but it also demands a completely different way of creating brands, of shaping brands. And it kind of goes back to the thing I talked about, but what are we essentially selling? So I get, when I'm home in Copenhagen anyway, I get a box of vegetables delivered to my door, and it comes with recipes, so it got everything that I need for cooking. And I'm one of those guys who want to do more vegetarian food, and that's kind of like a food journey, because if you grew up in Denmark in the 80s and 90s, everything you'd get is overboiled broccoli, really, really heavy gravy and meatballs. That's kind of your diet. That's what I grew up with. So suddenly having to learn how to grow or to cook vegetarian foods demands quite a bit. So the interesting thing is I'm actually not really buying the produce, the organic produce. What I'm buying is that self-realization, that I'm buying into what that brand is doing for me, that they take me on a journey towards something I want. And I think that is really fascinating. Brands as an enabler. So I think we come from this time where all the do-good stuff is almost like masturbating in public. You have all these brands saying, no, we're saving seagulls, we're doing, you know, selling millions of liters of water, we're doing all this stuff. But what are they fucking really doing for us? So I think we need to change the brand narratives away from being a story about all the good stuff the brands are doing, because by the end of the day, what is purpose really about? It's about my purpose. What can you as a brand do for me? Honestly, what can you do for me? And this is just two illustrations, not saying these are purposeful brands, but it's just to show the illustration. A brand that says, like Nike, that says, just do it. They enable me to do more stuff, to feel more stuff, to go further. And I think that is fascinating, because they are an enabler. They are a platform that facilitates all of this stuff. They facilitate the marketplace, that do something, that give me a voice. And I think that's interesting. So I'm going to share a couple examples from businesses who have done that. And of course, you know most of these campaigns, but one of them that I thought was really fascinating was Small Business Saturday, because remember when I talked about short-term thinking? In a way, this is not just a campaign. This is something that keeps going and going and going. So at the midst of, or in the middle of the kind of financial crisis in the US, they created this campaign to make people go and shop in the local businesses. And of course, the first year, good. But what I thought was really interesting is that that campaign has just kept growing and growing and growing. And now it's in the UK as well, and it's doing really well. So they almost created a platform where they gave a voice to all these small business owners. So they didn't create a campaign, but they created a platform for people to make a campaign. So they understood this human part marketplace. One of the movements I think, Me Too movement's super interesting. One of the movements I think is super interesting is every time in November when some of us men grow a moustache. So the whole November movement, right? And what's super interesting about the November movement is that it's one of the fastest growing nonprofits of all time. And today it's one of the 100 biggest nonprofits of all time. Because they don't fucking think like the super conservative Red Cross and Amnesty International. Those organizations claim to be grassroots, but they got like a super bureaucratic way. I mean, everybody who's tried to do a campaign for any of those brands know how fucking bureaucratic it is. It's almost impossible to get anything through. What Movember said was, let's do it differently. Let's empower people. Everybody who wanna take part in this, everybody who wanna show that they wanna support this important cause, they can do it. And it's really simple, it's just growing a moustache. And one of the co-founders, Adam Garone, I think he really kind of nails it, says, we really hand over the campaign to those people to run with it. We empower those who take part. So how often do you as creatives create campaigns that empower people to create campaigns? Or how often do you create a way for people to co-create the products or co-create the services? One of the campaigns that a lot of you probably have seen, and the first time I saw it, I think we had in the D&AD Impact Awards as well last year, but was Rye. We talk about consumption, right? So, of course, it's an outdoor retailer. It makes a lot of sense. The target group loves the outdoors. So let's just close the fucking whole store and ask people to go outside. Pretty simple. And when I first saw it, I thought, okay, another goddamn advertising gimmick, you know. Does this really change anything? Do they actually get people to go outside and enjoy nature? The year after, I saw this article, and I thought that was really, really interesting. Not only did they get 2 million people to pledge that they wanted to go outside, but the state parks in the US actually opened up the parks and saw more people visiting the state parks. I think that's interesting, because again, they didn't create a campaign, but a platform for change. I think there's a lot of ways you can do it. This is kind of like an old campaign, but I really loved it because it's a pretty complicated story. But the thing is, these drakenfish are not indigenous to Colombia. So for some reason, they kill a lot of the local sea life, marine life, whale. So normally, you'd probably do a campaign about that. But what they did was they created a recipe that gave people some tools to create these fishing tools that could actually catch the drakenfish. So actually really solving the problem by doing a platform, by enabling people to do something. So there's often this quote that says, it's not about giving people fish, it's teaching people how to fish, or even better, revolutionize the fishing industry. And I think we got to catch up with some of this stuff, because we're not that creative. It seems like people are fucking getting this. So I tried to look at, and this is still early days, as I said, this is kind of leading early research into the stuff I'm writing on, but so try to look at what is it, what are the success criteria for some of this stuff? How do you actually move away from creating campaigns to creating platforms? What are kind of the criteria that kind of makes it a platform? So these are kind of some of the ones that I've identified already. So an identifiable goal, something you fight for in drives is about opting outside. So a clear goal that you fight for. It's gonna be common. Everybody's, at least in the target group, who wanna participate, can participate, and they can take ownership and they create that campaign, which I think is amazing. Because rather than you guys having to spend media, spend all the time, you turn people into the ones who are ambassadors for your stuff. The third one is replicable. So you're gonna be able to make it again and again and again. If you wanna do like your little grow mustache thing, of course you can do it. So keep going. There gotta be some rules of engagement. In the Movember movement, grow mustache, that's the fucking thing. It's almost like a game. It's almost like a set of game rules, right? So what are the game rules that you need to apply for people to take part in this, to make people feel part of this movement? And of course, there's got to be a value add of some sorts. There's got to be something that you get out of it, where they're growing the moustache is like a social token, but there's got to be a value add. And the last thing, it's got to be open-ended. Remember what I talked about us being so short-term focused. We create campaigns end. How do we actually get out of that fucking thinking? Let's create stuff that enables itself to persist and go on and on and on. So I talked a little bit about Small Business Saturday, and I think it's truly fascinating that they've grown year on year and year, and a 40% increase from last year. So it kind of shows what happens when you suddenly build these platforms that enable growth, because it's exponential. You're not depending on internal marketing resources. You're not dependent on media spend, because you're handing everything over to people. So things grow faster. So this is an example from the world of marketing, but if you look at the world of products, it's kind of the same thing. What did Airbnb do? They said, let's turn everybody's bed into our beds. Really fucking simple, democratizing the hotel fucking business, and it's grown enormously. So I think we have every possibility to challenge what purpose is today, because I don't buy the purpose bullshit of a lot of these big companies anymore. Most of the time, because we can do the shit that they do better. Most of the stuff, to be honest, and let's be fair, we'll work on it daily, are substandard products. I mean, why should I buy a Häagen-Dazs or a Ben & Jerry's ice cream? We've got so many options that are made by people who actually do care. And I don't say that people in Unilever and Ben & Jerry's don't care, but it's a different thing. You feel the passion, you feel the purpose, you can feel that people go to work to make the fucking best possible ice cream in the nicest possible way. The very same thing that Ben and Jerry did back in the days. Today we just have a choice between what we want to support and what we want to do. So we can create a future that's for kind of the filthy, rich and few, or we can create something that are for everybody, that empowers everybody, that are democratized. And I think that is super, super interesting. So, not to make this political, this is not political, but one of the quotes that I really loved when President Obama ended his period as a president was that he talked about power in a completely different way. So he said, "Thank you for everything. My last ask is the same as my first. I'm asking you to believe not in my ability to create change, but in yours." And I think this, when we talk about purpose, I think this is what we should aspire towards. Creating brands that enable us to do more, feel more, say more, because I think that is essentially what purpose is about. I didn't start in the advertising industry to sell more diapers or cars or cheeseburgers. I started in the advertising industry because I believed in the power of creativity, and I just couldn't help jotting crazy ideas down on paper. And I think if we can enable, and if you can create campaigns and platforms that respect people, not the shit we do today, that respect people and respect people's intelligence and empowers them to do more stuff, I think that is fucking truly fascinating, and that I think is what we should be doing. So, to end this stuff off, I think we have an immense power today, and it's about realizing that your work and your voice matter. And for anybody who kind of want to be part of the kind of good advertising mission and formulating what is going to be the next thing and purpose, how are we actually going to do stuff that creates an impact, that changes people's lives, please submit some stuff to this platform and be part of the conversation. And it's been a pleasure discussing good advertising and purpose. I know there's a bit of time for questions as well. So thank you so much.